Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the second video in the I2C Slave series, and today we will continue from where we left in the previous video. We saw how to write a simple code for the slave to receive the data in the interrupt mode. If you remember, we wrote the function to receive 6 bytes of data, and set the transfer option as the first and last frame. This enabled the slave to receive 6 bytes of data, and if the master sent more than 6 bytes, the slave sent the NAC response. I also mentioned that since the slave is set to receive 6 bytes, if the master sends less than that, the slave will generate an acknowledgement failure error. Let's see it again. This is the previous project we worked with. Let me launch the debugger. Alright, it's ready now. I am putting a breakpoint in the error callback function. Let's send 2 bytes of data. I forgot to run the debugger. Alright, we have received the 2 bytes, and the breakpoint also got the hit. This means indeed there is an error. If you hover on the I2C, you can see the error code, that is 4. Let's see the I2C header file to know what error is this. Here you can see the error 4 corresponds to the AF error, that is acknowledgement failure error. If the master sends 6 bytes of data, we will not get any error, because it is supposed to receive 6 bytes. But sending less than that, will trigger the AF error. This error arises because the slave detects an early stop condition. We will talk about this in a while. The AF error is not an issue here. As long as we are receiving the data, it should be fine. We can just clear the error and move on with receiving. The problem with the previous code was that it only received a fixed amount of data. If we are using this code for communication between 2 devices, and we don't know how much data the master is going to send, we can't use it there. So today we will make changes to the code, so that the slave can receive pretty much any amount of data, without sending a NAC response. In the previous video we used the transfer option, first and last frame. Today we will check out other options we have, like I2C first frame, next frame, and the last frame. The first frame is used to manage the start condition, and the data transfer is done without a final stop condition. The next frame is used to manage a restart condition, and the data transfer is done again without a final stop condition. The last frame is again used to manage a restart condition, but the data transfer is done with a final stop condition. You see how these options are very similar, yet different from each other. Basically, the first frame is used when you want to receive data, where the master is starting the communication. The next and the last frame is used to receive data, where the master is using a restart condition, basically in a situation where it wants to switch to a read from write, or vice versa. The last frame is used when the slave wants to end the transfer. It will receive the data with the option of the last frame, so as to indicate that it does not want to receive any more. This certainly does not mean that the master will stop transmitting, it's just that the master will send NAC after this. Let's see all of this in the operation now. Let's define some new variables first. The RX count will be used to keep the track of the buffer position. I am also defining different counters, so that we know which function was called how many times. When there is an address match, this address callback is called. Here we will first increment the address counter, and then the slave will receive 1 byte of data with the indication that it is the first frame. Once the slave successfully receives 1 byte, the receive complete callback will be called. Here we will increment the RX count, so that the new data can be saved at a new location in the buffer. If the RX count exceeds the buffer size, reset it back to zero, so that it starts overwriting the data from the beginning. This whole arrangement will make this reception in a circular buffer mode. Now we will again receive 1 byte of data, and store it in a new position in the buffer. This time we will provide the option next frame, indicating that the slave is ready to receive the next data byte also. Let's increment the RX complete counter. I am incrementing the error counter in the error callback function. Alright, everything is set now, let's build and debug the code. Let me add the counters in the live expression. Everything is set now, so let's send the 2 bytes of data first. Here we received the data in the first 2 bytes of the buffer. Notice that the address counter is 1, that means the address callback was only called once, whereas the received callback was called twice. Basically, when the master initiates the transfer, and there is an address match, the address callback gets called. Here the slave requests 1 data byte. On successfully receiving it, the receive complete callback is called, and the receive counter increments. The slave requests another data byte. On receiving a 2nd byte, the receive complete callback is called again, and the counter increments to 2. The slave requests another data byte, but the master is only sending 2 bytes. Hence a SOP condition is detected, while the slave was waiting for the data. This triggers the acknowledgement failure error, and the error counter is incremented to 1. Now if the master sends a new data, it will store at an updated position in the buffer. Since it's a fresh new data, where the master again starts with the address matching, the address counter is incremented again. Let's send 6 bytes now. It started from a new updated position, and once the data exceeded the buffer, it started overwriting the data from the beginning. Let's see it one more time. You can see the 7-8 overwrites the 1-2. The error will always be there each time the master transmits something. This is because the slave never sends a stop condition. The error actually arrives because the stop F bit is set in the status register. This happens because the slave detected a stop condition while it was waiting for new data to arrive. Anyway, we can ignore the error for now, we will handle it in future videos. So we are able to receive the data in a circular mode, where the new data overwrites the old data in the buffer. More importantly, the slave can receive as much data the master can send. This is it for this video. I hope you understood the concept. In the next video, we will make this receiving a little more interesting, more like an idle line interrupt case in UART. We will also see the usage of the option I2C last frame. That's it for today. The link to download the code is in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.